of Parliament at the National Assembly passed the Constitution of Kenya Amendment Bill 2020 last week on Thursday. Now, the MPs attained the required two-thirds majority to vote on this bill and to amend the Constitution. Now, the lawmakers at the National Assembly on Thursday gave the bill a clean bill of health. They said yes, they passed a yes to it, and at least 320 members participated in the vote at the second stage, where 235 supported the bill, with 83 voting no, and two abstained in regards to the voting. Now, the House then proceeded to the plenary, where voting was done in the third reading, and during this third reading, those who voted yes were 224, and those who voted no were 63, while two abstained. Now, this week, all eyes are on the Senate. MPs passed the bill last week. Will the senators pass the bill? At the county, at the parliamentary level, should we expect the same thing that happened at the National Assembly replicating itself at the Senate level? Do you support the bill? Will the senators say yes, or will they say no? Should the bill be amended, with alterations, or should it be passed as it is? These are the questions that we shall be discussing today. I'm joined by Paul Makoha, who has been with me since morning. He is an advocate of the High Court of Kenya and also an aspirant. Karibu sana, Bwana Paul. It is a pleasure. Thank you for keeping tabs with me since morning. Tumekuwa na wewe, and joining me in studio, I am with Derek Otwenyo. He is a youth leader and also mtu ambaye anawania kiti. Karibu sana, baba.
Asante.
And before to answer, let me first of all start by dispensing of these seats that you are vying for, because the BBI might affect it will affect you. Upendo sipende. When we look at the MPs, they passed the bill. We are looking at 235 votes for the bill against 83, a whooping 73% at the National Assembly. What do you make of this? Let me start with you, Otwenyo.
Well, first of all, I'd like to start by saying BBI is the silver bullet that Kenya needs. Because let us look at the gains instead of the few alterations here and there. The gains are much more, and they are beneficial even to the future generations of Kenya. That is one of the major reasons as to why many individuals support BBI. We as the youth who make up around 70% of the population, we do support the BBI. First of all, because of the various positions or rather the benefits of the BBI. And that is why even at the Senate, the BBI will pass. And
not,
you see,
but not all youth support the BBI.
Not all youths support the BBI, but you see, democracy is a fallacy, whereby the majority have their say. Yeah. So the majority, no matter the situation, will always have their say.
You feel like majority of youths support the BBI?
Definitely.
Do you see what happened? Are you seeing it happening again, whatever happened at the National Assembly? Will the Senate pass this bill this week?
Yes, definitely. It will pass.
It will pass.
Yes.
Let me come to you, Paul. What do you make of it? When the National Assembly passed, earlier on you said you had expected it to happen.
Yes, yes, definitely it is going to happen. I have no doubt about it. Mm-hmm. Yeah, even if, when you look at the what is provided for in the Constitution as regards the procedure for amending the Constitution, mm-hmm. yeah, which is being followed right now, even in the event the Senate does not pass it, it will has under the Article 257, it will still have to go to trigger down to the people.
By popular initiative.
Yes, yes, it has to go to the people. So that regardless of the outcome of the Senate decision, it is immaterial. Definitely is going to a referendum. Now, in addition to that, maybe may I also say, my brother said that it is a silver bullet that that Kenya needs. Personally, I would really look more, reflect back when President Uhuru and Honorable Raila Odinga stood on those stairs of Harambee on 9th of March 2018. they gave us 9-point agenda. And they said that according to them, these were the things or the concerns which they were now establishing this vehicle to come and look out into them. And some of them, there are things even like divisive elections, which of course bring this country into a lot of problems. So to me, what Kenya needs most is we need to look back and see what is the problem that faces Kenya. To me, that question of divisive elections, the issues of arrangement of IEBC, to me, it's a big question.
Now, Garissa, yes. Town Member of Parliament, you are talking about Honorable Aden Duale.
Yes.
He's one who voted no during the voting process.
Yes.
And he said it was founded, the BBI, was founded on, and I quote, lie that Kenyans should not be cheated, that once it's passed, it will cure the problem ailing the country. He said, and I quote, that there are many people who are telling us about inclusivity. I want someone to tell me if this bill has united Kenyans or divided Kenyans. He went on and said, the constitution are not meant for leaders, but for the people to check on the leadership. So he does not believe that it will cure the problems ailing the country.
Definitely, I agree with him to some extent. BBI cannot be a panacea for the problems facing Kenya. What is facing Kenya right now? The big question of poverty.
But
people are suffering. People are suffering like right now.
Didn't the BBI, didn't that handshake at the Harambee stairs, on that particular day bring peace to the country?
It did. And to me, that was for a moment, for example. Right now, we are going to the next election, 2022. And I'm sure and certain that if we don't cure the problems which Kenyans are facing, for example, Kenyans are right now struggling. And that is why, by the way, even BBI initiative itself, it's not a wrong thing, so to speak. And many Kenyans are acknowledging that. It's a good effort trying to find some solution to our problems. But I think to Kenyans and many people across the board, they are just saying there are quite a number of pressing things which Kenyans are concerned about. Right now, the issues of COVID, there are issues of businesses are struggling. There is an issue of corruption, which is costing this country a lot of money and all that. So I think if we were to look at the needs of Kenyans, what are really the needs of Kenyans? And that's why I always say that as leaders, when we are coming up with a process, for example, to amend the constitution, there are two ways to do it. There is either we do what you call interest-driven or need-driven. Interest-driven is what we are seeing right now. Interest-driven in the sense that, for example, you look at the political class, they are just looking, for example, we need to create this post for us to take care of the regions, to take care of ourselves. But if they were to look at what are the needs of the people, then they will adopt what you call need-driven process.
Derek, a response to that. Do you agree with him?
I don't agree with you totally. You see, in order to tackle a problem, you have to get to the roots of the problem. Take a look at what devolution brought. Right now, we have county governments.
Yes.
And we have county hospitals, county referral hospitals all over. We have industries coming up. What BBI entails, it will be from the revenue allocation, 35%. And the ward allocation, 5%. Won't this bring development? Because you find that the youth population down there, Mashinani, they really need and rely on this. Take a look at what devolution did to a county like Kakamega. Kakamega is very developed at the moment.
Yes.
Yeah?
Yes.
This is such a scenario where BBI will come in.
And that's where that's your county.
It's my county. And indeed, I appreciate it.
So it has developed.
Yes, it has developed.
So you agree BBI brought development.
And truly, by the way, within BBI, looking at it objectively, and which I do, looking at it objectively, BBI has good things. Personally, I support even the increase of financial allocation to the counties from 15 to 35%.
So you say Kakamega, counties like Kakamega, yes. Where it comes from. So you support that?
There are good things. There are good things in it. Okay, I'm saying...
You're contradicting yourself.
Okay,
you said that BBI is... And if I got you correctly,
yes.
You said there are two things.
Yes.
interest, it could either be interest-driven or need-driven.
Yes, yes.
And you said the BBI is interest-driven.
Yes, yes.
If it is interest-driven, how can that, which is interest-driven, bring positive change on a county where you come from and you acknowledge that it has actually done that?
It does not mean, what I've said, actually, I don't mean, and it cannot mean, that when a process is interest-driven, it is totally wrong. It's not. And that's why I'm saying, by the way, on that question whether I'm supporting BBI or not, we are yet to reach at the place where now we make a decision. And that will be at the referendum stage.
At the referendum stage.
Right now, we are looking at the process. We are looking at what it provides and arguing pros and cons. At the end of the day, of course, rationally, every person and every Kenyan is going to look on the good side. BBI has good these things, has bad of these things. Then at the end of the day, we are going to make a decision. So for me, that place of the decision, we are yet to reach there.
If you're not sitting at the table, then you'd rather break it. BBI, let us not overlook the few elements, say, that need amendments, like the imperial presidential, the prime minister post. Don't look at that. Look at the benefit. You as an aspirant, what benefits will your people back at home benefit from it? Yeah, county hospitals, roads, healthcare, and education. These are some of the main issues. Building bridges, across all the counties, across people. And you see, we are heading to a general election. Will after every general election be there bloodshed? No. That is why we are building the bridges. We are building the gaps. We are connecting the people.
What would be your reaction towards what, and I'll come back to you, Bonaparte.
Yes, yes.
Your reaction towards what Honorable Aden Duale said, that the BBI, it is founded on a lie, and he said that Kenyans should not be cheated, that once it is passed, it will cure the problems ailing the country.
Well, Ram, first of all, let us disassociate BBI with the likes of Raila Odinga. Then we see the benefits of the BBI. You see, there are differences, and we must disagree to agree. But then a leader opposing something that will bring change, positivity to his or her own people, that is not a leader. We have to focus on the positivity, as I said. Two-third gender rule, the youth. In as much as the youths were not included, but it is at least a step towards the better Kenya. The Kenya that the former president, Mwai Kibaki, had for Vision 2030. We headed there. Now, let us not associate BBI to different individuals. We cannot be talking about dynasties. We cannot be talking about the hustler nation. Let us look at this thing as a report, or rather as a changing factor for the country.
But Honorable Aden Duale believes that it has not brought more unity. In fact, he says, he was actually saying, I want somebody to tell me if the BBI united Kenyans or divided Kenyans. But anyway, moving on. The House Deputy Majority Whip also gave in his voice. That is Honorable Maoka Maore. He said, and I quote, those who are opposing the BBI are not opposing it because of its content, but because they feel sidelined, and it is this kind of politics that the BBI is addressing. Those opposing the BBI are bald-headed cowards.
On that, I may agree to some level of degree in this sense, that truly when you hear people who are raising those dissenting voices, the concern are that, no, we need more time to be heard. We need to explore more things. There are things which are appearing controversial, like increment of constituencies, for example. And there is a lot of murmurs and cries. Yes, yes, of an equal distribution of it. Those are things that people are getting concerned about, that at the end of the day, after we pass it, then how are we going to determine, for example, that Kiambu, for example, should have like this number of constituencies, should have more than, for example, Kakamega County. And when you look in terms of even geographical size and even population, they are almost equal in terms of those factors. So those are the things that people are raising. There are things that questions people are raising, even like ombudsman, where people are apprehensive that we may be taking back the judiciary to the dark days where the presidents and the executive had control of the judiciary. And may I say this, Mr. Bwanaram, there is a danger if to any level of degree we interfere with the independence of the judiciary. When you go back to 2007, one of the things that caused Kenyans to shed blood and fight, it was lack of faith and confidence in the judiciary, because they were saying judiciary is a puppet of the president and the executive. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter who has won. And those are the things that we must be clear about. And to me, really, if it was this process was being led by a need-driven process, the way I said, things like independence of the judiciary should lay the core discussion of this process. We should be discussing on the issue of, for example, independence of the judiciary as regards financing of it. The current constitution creates what you call the judiciary kitty, or the judiciary should sustain itself in terms of finance. It should not depend on the exchequer, who are the executive. Those are the things we need to be now be looking at. How do we strengthen it? The things about this thing, my brother has also said about it, about BBI bringing employment and jobs to the youth and all that. To me, it is true and it's not true. To me, if we curb the issues of corruption and ensure that, for example, there are projects like Ulana Kulal, which all of them collapsed. There are projects like Imwarer. There are projects like, when you look in Western, factories that collapse. If those things, the question of corruption is addressed and all those things are running this country, youth definitely are going to have employment. This country, the business is going to be stable. It is going to attract investment. People are going to come here, and the economy definitely is going to be sound. So once we address that and we ensure all these projects are running and all the money, there is value for the money for common mwananchi, definitely these things we are speaking about, the youth and all that, it will be addressed. We don't need BBI, for example, to address that. But I'm saying at the end of the day, again, let those who are speaking about it, let those voices be heard, be given opportunity for those concerned to be addressed.
Do you agree with Maoka Maore's comment that those opposing BBI, according to his words, are cowardice?
Yes, to some extent I do believe that, because those people were given the opportunity to come forward to have their say in the BBI. But all they kept doing were what we call the tribal politics. So Maoka Maore is right, because we cannot be going back and forth. We need to channel on, or rather propel forward, because 2022 is here with us. We need to put certain aspects in place in order for us to have successful general elections. Elections not like the previous ones, yeah? So we need to move forward away from the BBI politics. They had their say at that time. They did not come out and speak. What they were doing was associating BBI to certain individuals, which should not be the case for well-known leaders.
I'm looking at what he said. You said employment has been brought, and you are again saying it is a 50-50 issue. It is neither here nor there, based on what you said. Maybe I can get your reaction towards that in regards to the rate of employment. And if I would also add to that particular issue, your particular stand,
yes,
that BBI has the ability, if passed, to promote employment of these, because right now it has not yet been passed. We cannot say that it has done anything on the ground yet.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, we cannot speculate about job creation, because one of the major issues we are facing as a country is the oversight. By the oversight, I mean the oversight from the ward level up to the government, national government. Mm-hmm. You find that right from the governors, there is a misappropriation of funds. The legislature, which should be the watchdog, is not overseeing the funds. Thus, you see industries like Pan Paper in Webuye crumbling down. There is no oversight. But once we once we curb on the oversight, then I think lack of employment would be a thing of the past.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because to me, that is the only hiccup you're facing at the moment.
I'm looking at what Honorable Junet Mohammed said.
Mm.
He said that we are going to have an inclusive government as a position will be shared equally among communities in the country. There are the ills that this BBI is trying to cure. Let us not forget where we are coming from. Mm. Your thoughts?
Of course, that statement, I may disagree with it, because when you look at Kenya has over 42 tribes. So even if you say, for example, that this BBI is going to cure, because there has been a big question of tribalism and all that. So I know one of the angering reasons of the proponents of BBI has been that, for example, we create some extra posts so that we try to balance out, so that if one person from this tribe takes the president, another one from another tribe will take maybe prime minister's post and all that. But to me, at the end of the day, definitely, we cannot satisfy all that.
Mm.
But to me, and I would wish to support what he said, the statement of if there is a good accountability and oversight, because he has mentioned the issue of weak oversight. And by the way, indeed, it is true. You look at this country, for example, right now, the country is overburdened by debts, international debts, to the tune of over 7 trillion. I think that should be the case. And that is the cry of people. And you know, there is even fear that maybe in near future, some of our main resource entities, like even Port of Mombasa, there are fears that, you know, it may be auctioned by the banks which have loaned us money. And when you look at that question of the money we are taking, for example, the MPs are supposed to consent or to give an okay to any increase of borrowing money. So you find that truly, the way he has said, when there is a weak oversight, because right now what is happening in Kenya, you find what executive has proposed, it has no doubt it will go through, it will pass in parliament. And to me, that is really a weak oversight. MPs ought to be strong. They need to know that they are representatives of the people, they have mandate of the people, they have to take care of the interest of the people. They have to ensure that they are whatever step or decision or position they take, it reflects the goodwill of the people. But anything which is going to injure the lives of people, which is going to affect the country at the long term, MPs ought to stand out and say no to it. But unfortunately, that is not the case at the moment. It is like the parliament is a puppet of the executive, which is quite unfortunate. Let's hope that as we move, that maybe the country is going to have good leadership.
The parliament has not been a puppet. It has been working independently.
What do you mean is not a puppet? Tell me any motion in the last 5 years which was fronted by executive and it was shut down. You'll find that there is none. Everything that the executive proposes, it goes through.
You know, that's another debate. That
yes.
I concur with him.
Yes.
Because.